Okay, so yesterday we essentially saw the main components of the capacitance associated with a transistor, right? If we want to sort of draw a quick summary of what it is, this is what it looks like. These are the four terminals of the transistor: the gate, drain, source, and bulk, right? And effectively what we have is the various components of the capacitance. There is a gate to bulk capacitance, right? Or a gate capacitance, essentially it's just called the gate capacitance because it is the capacitance seen at the gate terminal, right? But at the same time there is also a gate to drain and a gate to source capacitance, right? Which one is active? Is it the gate to bulk or is it the gate to drain and gate to source? Depends on whether the channel has formed or not. After the channel has formed, the bulk is effectively screened away from the gate. Okay? And the capacitance is effectively a capacitance between the gate and the source and drain terminals due to the conducting channel present over there. Okay? But as far as we are concerned, finally the important thing will be that there is one combined gate capacitance that you can sort of talk about. All of these are related to the insulating layer between the gate metal and the substrate. Okay. Apart from this, there are two more capacitances: the drain to bulk and source to bulk capacitance. Okay. These correspond to the depletion capacitances associated with the N plus diffusion regions in the case of an NMOS MOSFET. Right. So because they are associated with the diffusion regions, they are usually also called the diffusion capacitances or depletion capacitances. Those words are sometimes used interchangeably. Depletion because that's the mechanism of the capacitance, diffusion because they correspond to those regions. Okay. So usually we talk about something like the drain diffusion capacitance or the source diffusion capacitance. Okay. So this is a very rough sort of diagram showing where the capacitances are that matter to us. Okay, what the relative values are and so on depend on the size of the size of the transistor. The W and L of the transistor have a direct influence on the gate capacitance. The W and the LD or LS, the length of the source and drain regions, have an impact on the diffusion capacitances, the drain and source diffusion capacitances. Okay. Now, like I said, all of these capacitances are voltage dependent. They actually depend on the instantaneous voltages that are present across these terminals, right? But what we typically do is, since in digital circuits we are primarily interested in the two extremes of operation, either I am completely at cutoff with VG equal to 0, or usually I am in saturation with VG equal to VDD, right? Whether it is saturation or the linear region depends on the VDS value. But it is on essentially. Okay, so corresponding to those two extremes of operation, we have sort of taken some average values of the capacitance, and those are the values that we usually use in order to represent this. So in other words, we can actually talk about the capacitance of a MOSFET, right, and treat it as sort of a single value that we use while estimating various things such as the propagation delay and so on. Okay. So as we go further, we will essentially talk about this entire system as though a MOSFET has a single capacitance associated with it. But what you need to keep in mind is that in reality, those capacitances themselves are voltage dependent and therefore time varying. What we are doing is working with an approximate average that helps us to do first order calculations of the numbers. Okay. Now, we looked at the components of all of these things. Apart from this, there is one other effect which sort of comes into the picture, which I'm going to neglect now. We'll look at it later if necessary, if time permits, right? Which is that you will see that, you know, this gate to drain capacitance, for example, all of you would be familiar with how a MOSFET can be used as an amplifier, right? Essentially, you could use it in such a way that you would apply the input signal at the gate terminal, get the amplified output at the drain terminal. In such a circumstance, if you put a capacitance across the input to output of an amplifier, what happens? There's a name given to that effect. What is it? The Miller effect, right? So the Miller effect essentially says, if I take an amplifier and connect a capacitance across its input to output, then the effective capacitance looks possibly larger than the actual value of the capacitance that was there, depending on the value and the sign of amplification and so on. Okay. Now, these kind of MOSFETs, especially when they are being used in the form of inverters and so on, as a very rough approximation, can be considered as unity gain inverting amplifiers. Okay. And therefore, that Miller effect does come into the picture, and some of these capacitances can look larger than they actually are. Okay. Once again, for the time being, we are going to neglect that effect. In practice, it is something that needs to be taken into account. It can actually, because it's a 2x change in the capacitance that you are talking about over there, not like 10%. Okay. So because of that, in practice, it turns out that very often you do need to make allowances for this capacitance, and sort of the models that are used in order to estimate various things such as the power consumption and so on nowadays do take this into account. Okay. But as far as we are concerned, it doesn't affect the direct notion of where the capacitances come from, so we will leave it at that for. Okay. So now that we understand where the capacitance associated with the MOSFET is coming from, let's go to the next stage and talk about the equivalent resistance, okay, of a MOSFET. So why are we interested in the equivalent resistance? Essentially what we are saying is, I am going to use this MOSFET like a switch. Let's say this is the drain, source and gate. Okay. Some potential drop across it, some current flowing through it. Okay. Now, whether this current flows or not depends on the value of VG. If VG is 0 or low, then this current is going to be negligibly small. It's going to be probably in the nano amps to pico amps range. So I don't really need to worry about it. Okay. I'm more concerned with the case where it is actually on. So VG is high, okay, and the VDS is essentially causing a current to flow. Okay. What we do is we say that this kind of transistor is essentially equivalent to something which looks like this, a switch with a resistance in series. Okay. And we say that essentially this switch has been closed, then VG becomes high, and the effective resistance, the drain to source resistance, is what we call R equivalent. Okay. Now in practice, or in reality, this is not just a fixed resistance. Okay. There is some resistance to the flow of current, but it's not a constant value. Okay. So once again, just like we did for the case of capacitance, what we need to do is find out some approximate average which can be used in order to replace the entire equivalent model. Okay. And the question is, how do we estimate this average? Okay. So in order to do that, I'm going to look at one common mode of operation of, or one common mode in which the NMOS transistor operates, tell you what are the regions of VDD or the VDS of the transistor that we are interested in, and based on that we will try and estimate how can we find an approximate average or equivalent. Okay. So as far as an NMOS transistor is concerned, as we will see later as we start building gates out of these transistors, the most common mode in which it is used will be something like this. There will be an NMOS transistor with source terminal connected to ground, gate terminal connected to VDD, so it is on. And what this NMOS transistor is doing is discharging a capacitor. Okay? we'll call that CL, the load capacitance. Okay. Now in practice, where does this load capacitance comes from? From various contributions such as the gate inputs of the next gate that you are connecting it to, the drain diffusion of this transistor itself, and so on. Right? We'll look at all that a bit later. The important point is this is the rough equivalent circuit model of what is happening. And we want to find out, if I replace it with this, what is this R equivalent, which will give me the same sort of discharge time. Okay, what will happen in this is there will be some current that flows through, right, some ID, and over here also there will be some current that flows. Okay, assume that this capacitance is initially charged to VDD. And then gate voltage is made equal to VG or the switch is closed. In both those cases, the current starts to flow. It will cause the capacitor to discharge. Right? On the right hand side, what will this curve look like? If I look at VC, the voltage across the capacitance, as a function of time, assuming that the switch is closed at time 0, what will the voltage look like? It will be an exponential decay, right? So we all know this. It is something going to be some VDD, the initial value, into e to the power of what? E to the power of minus t by R equivalent into CL, right? So this is just normal first order circuit, right? The current, depending on what the current flow is, this is how the voltage will decay across the capacitance, right? What it means is initially when t is equal to 0, the voltage is equal to VDD. As t tends to infinity, the voltage tends to 0. It's possible to define some point over here. Usually we define the 50% point, right? When does the voltage become VDD by 2? And we calculate that time and we call this the propagation delay. Okay? So the propagation delay essentially says how much time does it take in this case when the system is basically a capacitor that's discharging through the equivalent resistance, how much time does it take for that voltage at the output to drop to 50% of its initial value, or to go from VDD to VDD by 2. Okay, that's just how we define propagation delay, which automatically means that's what we are interested in. Okay, now what would the curve look like for the left hand side? If I again look at VC, the voltage across the capacitor as a function of time, what's going to happen as soon as I close the switch? What mode of operation does the transistor go into? So what do I mean by that? And this is a very important question. It will keep coming up repeatedly, right? We want to know in what mode of operation a given transistor is, so that we can apply the correct equations and estimate the current flowing through it. Okay? Initially it will be in saturation. Why? How do we find out in which mode a transistor is operating? You look at its voltages. Right? What voltages? You look at the VGS and the VDS. Right? In this case, conveniently for us, the source is at ground. So we don't need to worry about VSB and so on. Right? So VGS and VDS are the only two things we need to worry about in this case, which are actually just VG and VD, right? Because source is at ground potential. Okay? Right, so what is VGS at t equal to 0? VGS, because I have closed this, I have applied the on voltage to the transistor, VGS is equal to VDD. Okay? What is VDS? Also equal to VDD. Okay? What are the three values in that Beeman computation? There was VGS minus VT, VDS and VDSAT. Okay, VGS is equal to VDD, so VGS minus VT is VDD minus VT, 1.8 minus typically 0.4 volts or so. Threshold voltage is usually around 0.4 volts. VDS is VDD, 1.8 volts. VDSAT is a constant, typically that is somewhere in the region of 0.3 to 0.5 volts, somewhere around that. Okay, it depends on the actual transistor that you are using. Okay, but in any case, it's going to be significantly lower than either of those two other numbers that you had, which means that actually speaking, the transistor straight away goes into the velocity saturated mode of operation. Right? So what does that mean, velocity saturated? It means that the VGS is high, channel has formed. The VDS is so high that we have gone beyond the, we have gone straight into the velocity saturation regime, right? The electric field has become so high that electrons are no longer able to accelerate any further. They have hit their saturation velocity and the current is just determined by that. It doesn't matter whether it was high enough to cause pinch off or not. Before that, the current has already stopped increasing because of velocity saturation. Okay. So, anyway, what that means is some current, which is the velocity saturated current, starts flowing. Okay. So, what does that mean? It will cause the voltage to start dropping. Okay. Whether it will be a straight exponential drop or whether it will sort of slowly start and then increase, that depends on the actual nature of the current and how it varies as a function of the voltage. Right? Because as soon as current starts flowing, the VDS starts changing, which means that the current in turn is affected by that. Okay. So it's a sort of feedback mechanism. I mean, not feedback, but to solve this, you have to do it iteratively. You basically make a small change in the voltage, find out how that impacts the current, that in turn changes the voltage, that in turn changes the current. A simulator like SPICE does this perfectly for you. Right? It's not something you can do by hand, but a simulator just does exactly this. This is what it's meant to do. Okay, so it starts out, the voltage starts dropping. After it has dropped for a certain amount of time, what happens? What happens as the VDS keeps on dropping? At some point, it will move into the linear region. Why? Because VDS will now become the smallest of those three quantities. It becomes smaller than VDSAT. VGS minus VT is still high. But when VDS becomes small, the transistor moves into the linear region. Still current continues to flow, so it will continue to sort of decay. Okay? Then will the current stop flowing? VGS is not changed. VGS is always at VDD. When VDS becomes 0. Right? So unlike the capacitor, which only tends to 0 as V tends to infinity, this one will actually hit 0 at some point. Right? Or close enough to 0 that it doesn't matter. It will essentially go below, you know, it will go into like deep sub-threshold, it will keep on discharging. At some point it sort of goes exponential. So if you actually look at it, you will find that it's still sort of decaying away. But it will decay much more rapidly than the exponential due to the RC. Okay. In any case, for this also, we can now define this 50% point as our propagation delay. So what we are concerned with is, how do I estimate this equivalent R, which can be used in order to create the simplified circuit on the right, okay, and allow me to form a quick estimate of what that propagation delay is. Because on the right hand side circuit, I don't need to know anything further about the transistor. I just take R equivalent into C, that's the time constant, right? R equivalent into C into some, you know, log of 2 will essentially, or natural log of 2 will essentially give me the time required in order to fall by from full to 50%. Okay, so around 0.7 RC or so. Right, we'll just take it as RC as the time constant. That's essentially what we are interested in as far as the propagation delay is concerned. Okay, so if I can find an R equivalent for a transistor, it means that my calculations in terms of estimating my propagation delay are going to be much simpler. Okay, and that's what I would like to do. Right? Okay. So, question is, how do we do that? Okay. In this particular model, where I've got the transistor discharging an output capacitance, what I'm going to say is the instantaneous R can be defined as the drain voltage or drain to source voltage divided by the current. Right? And the actual R equivalent, I'm going to just average this over the time that it takes to discharge. Okay? Assuming that I start at time t1, go up to time t2, right? Now I don't know the time. I know that at t1 equal to 0 I am starting discharging, that's just I have called it t1 equal to 0, but I don't know what t2 is. That's part of what I am trying to find out, right? So instead of doing this, what we do is we say, what do I know instead about this? What is the relationship that I know between VDS and ID? I actually have a curve which tells me that for that given value of VGS, this is what the VDS or ID versus VDS looks like. So I can do a sort of variable substitution. Instead of integrating over time from t1 to t2, I say at time t1, VDS is equal to VDD, and I know that at time t2, when I stop my averaging, VDS must be equal to what? What range am I interested in? From VDD, I want to discharge down to VDD by 2. Okay, so at t2, it must be equal to VDD by 2. Okay? So I have one VDS 1 by ID 1, VDS 2 by ID 2. Okay? So I can replace the variables and essentially say R equivalent is equal to 1 over VDD by 2 minus VDD times integral from VDD to VDD by 2. V, which is the VDS, divided by ID sat into 1 plus lambda V, right? Where ID sat itself is equal to mu n C x W by L V D sat times V D D minus V T minus V D sat by 2. Okay? Because in this entire region V D S is greater than V D D by 2, I am assuming that V D D by 2 is greater than V D sat, therefore we are in the velocity saturated region. Okay? And we end up getting this value for I D sat. It's more or less a constant, but then because of that slope is accounted for by the 1 plus lambda V term. We could neglect it, it doesn't really make too much difference to the final result. Okay? But it turns out that if you actually do this computation, right, and simplified terms over here, we can get an expression which essentially says this is equal to 3 by 4 VDD by ID sat. This is the main component that we are interested in. But if we also need to take the channel length modulation into account, then it will have an additional effect of 1 minus 7 by 9 lambda. lambda Vd. Okay. So this 1 minus 7 by 9 lambda Vd you can probably ignore. That is typically a relatively small quantity. Okay, or rather the 7 by 9 lambda Vd is a relatively a small quantity, so it does not change much from 1. The 3 by 4 Vdd by Id sat is your main component. That's your first order approximation of the equivalent resistance is essentially 3 by 4 Vdd by Id sat. Right? It's easy to see. At one end, you had Vdd. So at this end, right, you just had Vdd divided by Id sat. At this end, you had Vdd by 2 by Id sat. Same current in principle. Right? So overall it is Vdd by Id sat plus Vdd by 2 Id sat divided by 2, which is 3 by 4 Vdd by Id sat. Okay? So this 3 by 4 Vdd by Id sat is a reasonable approximation to the resistance that you actually have through the transistor, right, as it is going through that discharge phase. Okay, and we will use this for our computations essentially to sort of estimate what the equivalent resistance should be. Okay, sorry, can you raise your hand? I can't see. Yeah, be in the linear region. No, Vt is typically around 0.4 volts. Okay, so what are the values that we have over here? VGS is equal to Vdd is equal to 1.8 volts. Typical. Okay, I'm just giving approximate numbers over here. Vt is equal to 0.4 volts. Vd sat, let's say, is 0.5 volts. Okay, so what that means is VGS minus Vt is equal to 1.4 volts, Vdd by 2 is equal to 0.9 volts, and Vd sat, well, it's 0.5 volts. So even at the halfway point, Vd sat is still the smallest of these three quantities. Therefore, it is velocity saturated. Okay? Yeah. No, like I told you, it is seen even when you have velocity saturation. So channel length modulation as an effect is, the explanation that I gave makes sense when you think about it in terms of pinch off. But the effect is seen also when you have velocity saturation, right? So what happens is even though the transistor is velocity saturated, that increase in ID as VDS increases is still observed. The same equation is used in order to model that as well. And it is clubbed under channel length modulation. The mechanism is not exactly the same as in the case of pinch off, but the effect is the same. So we use the same equation, we still have that parameter. Yeah.
You are changing the range
like
Vdd to Vdd
to Vdd, why not from 0 to 2? Because of what I showed over here, right?
Address is probably simple.
Huh?
I am
interested in computing propagation delay, right? So basically, I am trying to model the transistor followed by capacitor which I have on the left, which is my actual circuit. I want to model it as my R equivalent C, which is on the right hand side, which is my approximate circuit. Okay? For what purpose am I trying to model it? Because I want to estimate the propagation delay. That is my main purpose over here. So for propagation delay, I am interested in how long does it take to decay from VDD to VDD by 2 for the NMOS transistor discharging a capacitance. For PMOS transistor, it will be the opposite. It will be charging a capacitance, but there also it will have to go from, you know, VDD by 2 to VD or something like that. Right? So it will be a similar kind of setup that we are talking about there also. Alright? So this is essentially the, so now we know what the equivalent capacitance of a transistor looks like, what the equivalent resistance looks like, at least in this part of operation of the circuit, right? as the transistor moves further down, as the voltage across it drops below VDD by 2, the resistance sort of changes. You can still model it approximately in this way and get an average value and so on. What you use it for is depends on what your requirements are. Okay. Alright. So with all of this, so far I have exclusively focused on the problem of NMOS transistors, right? What we have next is essentially the question of PMOS transistors. What happens in the case of PMOS? The structure looks something like this. You have P plus, insulator, metal, N-type substrate. Okay? So the first question that we are going to ask is, does this mean I need two substrates? Because for the NMOS transistor, I needed a P-type substrate. For the PMOS transistor, I need an N-type substrate. How am I going to get both together? Okay? So what is done is to say, I'll have an overall P-type substrate. Within that, I'll create something called a well. Okay? An N well, which is a large area, much larger, not much larger, but slightly larger than what the transistor needs to be, which is completely doped with N type. Okay. Now that part of it has essentially become an N type material, and the rest of the structure, you know, I can then put in the gate, I can put the P plus diffusions around it and create a P plus N P plus PMOS transistor. Okay. Sometimes what is done is you have a wells for both. You have an overall neutral substrate. You use P wells for the NMOS transistors, N wells for the PMOS transistors, just to sort of keep uniformity between them. Okay. How exactly it is constructed and so on entirely depends on the manufacturing process. So right now we don't care. The important part is it can be done. Okay. Now, the important thing as far as a PMOS transistor is concerned is, it's sort of a, at least I find it a bit of a pain to analyze, because all the voltages are negative. Okay, so sort of keeping track of what happens over there, when does it invert, what happens, what is the voltage required and so on, can get a little tricky if you are not careful. Okay, the important thing to keep in mind is, it's usually drawn the other way, right? Whereas in the NMOS transistor, the source was at the bottom, drain is at the top. Again, that's just convention, right? Over here, the source is typically at the highest voltage. Therefore, it's drawn towards the top. Okay? The source in this case is a P plus. Right? It has to be kept at the the source has to be kept at that, of course, the body, which is N type in this case, has to be kept at the highest potential. Otherwise, you end up with a P plus N forward bias junction. So the body in this case is N type, right? Even though the overall substrate might be P, the well in which the PMOS transistor is created is N type. Therefore, as far as the PMOS transistor is concerned, the body or substrate is N type, okay? And that region needs to be connected to the highest potential in the circuit to prevent these forward bias junctions. Apart from that, the source is usually connected up to VDD. You have VG over here, okay? Which means that VG is always going to be somewhere between 0 to VDD, which means that VGS is a negative quantity. Same way VDS is going to be less than or equal to 0, right? When does this invert? When the VGS has become sufficiently negative that it's able to attract enough holes to that interface to overcome the N-type body and make it a inverted channel. Inverted channel in this case basically means the N-type has inverted and become P-type, the accumulation of holes at that surface, right, in this region. just under the gate. Okay. For that, the VGS has to be negative. Only then holes are going to get attracted to that terminal or to that surface. Okay. Which means that effectively the threshold voltage, the point at which that inversion occurs, is the value of VGS at which that happens. The threshold voltage is also negative. Okay. So in other words, the simple way to think about it is, a PMOS transistor, all of these parameters have essentially just changed sign. Okay. The current, normally current flows from drain to source in the case of NMOS. Over here it's going to flow from source to drain. Okay, in the case of the PMOS. Okay. Or in other words, the IDS can be considered negative. Okay, drain to source current can be considered negative. Okay. So pretty much if you sort of invert all of those signs, you can work with it. Now, having said that, for convenience, right, just in terms of understanding, right, there are two things that are typically done. One of them is to say, I will always work only with the magnitude of the voltages. Right? So in other words, I will write down things like, for example, magnitude of IDS in a PMOS transistor is given by mu P epsilon aux by T aux WP by LP, magnitude of Vmin into magnitude of VGS minus magnitude of VT minus magnitude of Vmin by 2, where Vmin right. This is sort of one simple way of dealing with this. Right? You say that I will deal with everything in terms of magnitudes. My equation remains exactly the same. Okay? But I now need to be careful and make sure that my relative potentials are such that current will actually flow. Right? I need to have Vg less than Vs for the channel to form. Right? Vgs has to be negative. Same way, VDS has to be negative, VD has to be less than VS, only then the current can flow in that direction, right? So as long as I make all of those, I take all of those things into account, in terms of the computations, the actual numbers, I can just plug in the magnitudes in the equation and exactly the same equation which I used in the case of NMOS will work. What are the differences? WP and LP are pretty much the same, right? Once again, I have the situation where LP is a minimum size length. It is also 180 nanometers for PMOS, right? So just because it's PMOS, we don't necessarily make it any bigger or longer channel. Whatever WP, the minimum size WP is still 4 lambda or 360 nanometers. Epsilon aux, is that the same or different? It's the same. It's just the silicon dioxide. It has nothing to do with the N-type or P-type substrate, right? So the C aux, the epsilon aux by T aux is actually the same whether it's NMOS or PMOS. Okay? What about mu P? This is now the mobility of holes. Okay? Under a given electric field. There, what we actually see is, it turns out that because of the mechanism by which holes actually move in the substrate, right? It's sort of more complex for them to move readily under the influence of an electric field. The speed that they pick up is typically lower than the speed picked up by the electrons, which is modeled in terms of the mobility. Typically, what we have is mu P is less than mu N. Okay? For 180 nanometer process, it turns out that mu P is approximately half of mu N and we will use this as our approximate value for all estimates going forward. Okay? For older generations, mu P was around one third of mu N. For newer generations, this discrepancy has become less. Okay, so PMOS and NMOS are no longer so different as you go to even smaller technologies, right? But the point is, we just need to know if they are different, how do we deal with it? What happens? I need to somehow make their currents equal. If mu T is lower, what can I do to make the current equal to that of an NMOS? Which part of this can I compensate most easily? I can change the W. Right? If I want a PMOS and NMOS to deliver the same magnitude of current under the same settings of relative VGS and so on, the simplest thing that I can do is make the PMOS twice as wide as the NMOS. Okay, to compensate for that reduced mobility. And that is in fact what we will do in all of the designs as we go forward. Okay? Alright. Alright, so there's one other factor that I want to quickly take up over here, which is the effect of scaling. Okay, I might have to continue with this in the next class, but anyway, I'll just start off on it now. Right? What do we mean by talking about scaling? Right? What we are saying is, we started off few decades ago, when people started making integrated circuits with transistor widths and lengths that were in the order of several microns, right? 2 micron, 5 micron and so on. Okay, those were the smallest sizes that people could draw. But how many of you have heard of this term called Moore's law? Or rather, how many of you have not heard of it? Okay, good. So everybody still knows about Moore's law. Moore's law was essentially stated somewhere in the mid 1960s, right, by Gordon Moore, one of the founders of Intel. And essentially he sort of was extrapolating an observation from that time, right, which was that it's stated in many different ways. One way of stating it is to say that the number of transistors that you can pack into a given area is going to double every 2 years. Okay, which was later on revised to say it will double every 18 months. Okay, so what that essentially means is that the number of transistors that you can pack into a given area of silicon doubles every 18 months. Okay, that prediction or that observation held true for a very long time. Okay, to some extent people argue that it is still valid even today, right, because the generations of technology are still shrinking. Right? But it is no longer really as relevant as when it started out over there. Right? So nowadays we are in this regime where people are not, and you don't hear this term Moore's law in every presentation that you attend. Right? People still know about it, but they don't care too much about it because it's no longer that effective at this point. Okay? But the important part is that scaling effect was there and still is to a large extent. And essentially the way that you can think about it is, you are going to double the number of transistors in a given area in every generation, which means that the average feature size is going to be shrink by a factor of how much? Root 2. Okay, square root of 2. Right? So which is why if you go back and look at the generations of, you know, transistor technology, you would find that at one point there was a 0.5 micron process. What is the next one after that? 0.35 micron, right? Approximately 0.7x. Then you have 0.25 micron, which is 0.7 into 0.35, right? Or 0.5 of 0.5, right? Then you come to 0.18, which is where we are actually studying the present course, right? After that, it went to 0.13. From there, we essentially went to 90 nanometer. People stopped talking about microns and went to nanometers. 65, 45, 32, or 28, 22. After that, it gets a bit fuzzy, right? So at this point, people are no longer talking about that strict sticking to the square root of 2 reduction and so on, right? All of these generations exist. Why are we still discussing this generation as far as this course is concerned, because the fundamental processes of how transistors work, what are the non-idealities, what are the things you need to consider when you are actually building circuits out of them, do not change as you go further down the line to a first order. There are certain changes which come. For example, even the PMOS versus NMOS difference is quite different at lower technologies than what it is now. But it's just a question of changing the numbers. Okay? There are concepts like FinFETs and so on which change leakage and other kinds of things very dramatically from what it is that we have right now. But once again, conceptually, in terms of the design of the gates, very similar structures are used even now. Okay? So because of that, 180 nanometers is a relatively easy technology for us to sort of discuss and work with, which is why we are sticking with that. But the scaling itself happens pretty much by a factor of root 2 in every generation and has continued for several generations as we go further. Each of these steps is roughly 18 months or so, 1.5 years. Right? So you can sort of see how many decades essentially this thing has continued through. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. In the next class, there are two things I want to see. One is this scaling itself. How do we do it in different ways? Right? What are the different sort of ways of modeling the scaling that is applied to circuits? Then comes a question of how do we look at the resistances of slightly more complex, resistance capacitance value of slightly more complex circuits, and then we'll start on the CMOS inverter. Okay?